A very good afternoon to one and all present here. So in the previous, let us quickly have the recap of what is being done in the previous session. In the previous section, we have discussed about the sub-B instruction, MUL instruction, and as well as the DIV instruction. We also carry forward with logical bitwise operations such as AND, OR, and the XOR. And through each of these, we have taken small little examples and seen how these instructions can be used and how the results can be obtained using those instructions. We'll move ahead with the further set of instructions related to logical operations. But off the line, let us quickly look into the bit addressable RAM. Okay, so this is already what we have done, but this is required for us to understand the instructions related to bit address. As we are aware that the total memory, right, is being divided into different sections. You have the byte address, then the ports, as well as the bit addressable. And you have 16 bytes of the memory, which is bit addressable, as you can see onto the slide over here, right? So from the byte address 20 to 2F, right, to 20H to 2FH is the area of the memory which is bit addressable. That means every byte address 20 has an address which is bit ones. Like for example, if you see in the byte address 20, the bit 0 has the address to be a 0. Bit 1 has 1, 2, 3 and 7, so on. So if at all it is 21, its bit address is 0, right? That will have, I mean, the bit 0 will have the address to be a 08. Bit 1 will have 09 and so on. Then similarly, if you look into the ports that are which are SFRs, right, all the ports P0, P1, P2, P3, right, and other bit addressable SFRs also have the addresses for every bit along with the byte address. So for the byte addressable, like for example, if you take a port 0, if you take port 0, its byte address is 80, which means this complete address, fine, that is 0, 1 and 2, right, and then 3, 2, 7, this will be the direct address, right, and since there each of these ports are 8 bit, which means I require 3 bits to address each of the bits within the byte address. So these 3 bits which are being allocated will tell what is the bit position. Okay, for example, as I said, port 0, its byte address is 80H. But if at all we want the bit address of port 0.0. Okay, now this is the complete port 0 which is divided into 8 bits. So this is being represented as 0.0, 0.1, 0.2 and so on, which is 0.7. So when I read the port completely, it is 80H, the address. But if I have to read a particular bit, that means I have to associate the address along with the instructions. So in that case, the address for P0.0 will be 80H, for 1 it will be 81H, for 2 it will be 82H, and so on it will be 87H. So in the instruction, which are bit addressable, like for example, we have done the instruction as ANL, C, comma, bit address, right? So in the instruction with bit address, if we write ANL, C, comma, say for example, I write 83H. What does this mean now? This 83H is the address of the third bit of port 0. Its contents would be ANDed with the carry, and the result would be put back into the carry. Fine, I hope it's clear. So we have the bit addresses as well as the byte address. And there is a coincidence. I mean, you can see that the byte addresses are also from 0 to FF and the bit addresses also from 0 to FF. Other than that, the SFRs also have their bit addresses. So we have to be a bit cautious about using those bit addresses. Fine. So the reason why we took up this as a refreshing, because we have the instruction as set B bit address. So the same thing if I write instead of AND, taking example of port 0 itself, if I write the instruction as set B, say 84H. Okay, so what is this actually equivalent to? This 84H is nothing but P0.4. It is the address of port 0, fourth bit, port 0. Fine. So either I can write it as set B associated with P0.4, or you can also specify the address. Similarly, if I write the address as say 05H, now what is a 05H? Is the fifth bit of byte address 20H, because the bit addressable addresses, byte address start from 20H to 2FH. So the moment you write it as 05, it is the fifth bit of the byte address 20H, which will be set to a value of 1. So the next instruction that we have is set bit C, wherein you're changing the carry flag to a value of 1 in the PSW register. So we have the examples as set bit 85H. If I simply write 85, then it would be equivalently converted into the hex equivalent, and the corresponding bit of the bit addressable register would be set equal to 1. The same example we have taken to be as P1.4, which means that it is the fourth bit of port 1, which would be set to a value of 1, and we have the example as set B clear. So these are, two main instructions associated with set, that is set bit address and set bit the carry. Then similarly for the clear, we have got three instructions. Clear A stands for clear the contents of the accumulator. So it is again a byte instruction. So the contents of accumulator would be cleared, whatever is the previous. Similarly, we have clear C. As we have set BC, we have an instruction to clear the contents of the carry flag. So CLR C would be used. And next you have got CLR bit address, wherein it will clear the bit. If I take the same example, if you write it as set bit 05H, and then if you say CLR 05H, the first instruction would set the fifth bit, right, of the byte address 20H to a value of 1. And writing this instruction CLR 05H would clear off this bit. Okay, I hope the concept of bit addressable is clear. The next logical instructions we have is complement. So the instruction CPLA, it basically performs the ones complement. So when you want to perform the ones complement of any content, then we can use the instruction as a CPLA. So I see from the example, move A comma hash 65H and CPLA. So the A content, when we say 65, it is 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1. This is 65H. Before the execution of the instruction would be there in the accumulator. On you executing the instruction CPLA, it performs 1's complement. So what is the 1's complement of this? 0, 1, 0, 1, then 1, 0, 0, 1. So the equivalent value will be 9, and this is A. Fine. So this would be the result that would be loaded into the accumulator. And this does not affect any flag, and this instruction works with the accumulator. Then next we have the bit complement. That means if at all you want to complement the single bit of the bit addressable memory or the bit addressable SFRs, I mean port addresses a part of it. Then we can go in for using the same instructions there. So again, it performs the ones complement. The next instruction that we have is swap. So swap instruction does the interchange of the nibbles of the accumulator. That means when we use swap instruction, the lower nibble of the accumulator is exchanged or swapped with the higher nibble of the accumulator. Unlike exchange, it is a byte exchange that happens between the accumulator and the resistor or the memory address, but here it is between the resistor A itself, the higher and the lower nibble. For example, we have A to B as 45 loaded. So when we say A, 45, 4 and 5, so this is 0 to 3 and 4 to 7. And on using swap A, what will be the contents of the accumulator? This will contain 5 and the lower one will contain 4. That is how the nibbles are being swapped. So this this instruction can be used in equivalence to the rotate write instruction 4 times. Okay, which we'll take it up as I go through there. Right. So the next instruction that we have is the rotate instruction. The rotate instruction again operates only on the accumulator. With respect to the rotate instructions, there are 4 instructions: rotate right, rotate left, then we have rotate right with the carry, rotate left with the carry. So the first one we have is rotate left A. So when we consider an 8-bit number into the accumulator, what it basically does is, so this is the 8-bit, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7. So it is rotate right the contents of the accumulator. So the data which is there, fine, in the first bit will go into 0, 2 to 1, 3 to 2, 4 to 3, 5 to 4, 6 to 5, 7 to 6, and then whatever is here would get back into the data bank. Okay, that means write, rotate write does the job of putting the data from 1 to 0, 2 to 1 and so on. On the other hand, the rotate left A does the opposite. If I take the same 8-bit, this is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7. So the 0th bit would be moved to 1, 1 to 2, 2 to 3, 3 to 4, 4 to 5, 5 to 6, 6 to 7, and whatever is in the 7th bit would move on to the 0th bit. Okay, so this is how it operates. So let us look into the example that we have given. Move A comma with the rotate left as well as rotate right. Move A comma F0. A contains F0. So F is represented as 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0. And if you say rotate left, the contents of the accumulator, what is it? The 0th bit comes here, 0 comes into position 2, 0, then we say 0, 1 gets shifted, again 1 shifts into the 6th position, 6th position 1 gets shifted here, and this 1 which is there will be put back into the 0th position. So we get this to be as the result into the accumulator, which is nothing but E1 is the value which would be loaded into the accumulator. This is how a bitwise operation is being performed. Similarly, if we take the same example with A value as F0 and perform the rotate right with the accumulator, let's see what happens. 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0 and 0. So it is rotate right. So I start from the more significant. The 7 bit goes to 6, 6 to 5, 5 to 4, 4 to 3, 3 to 2, 2 to 1, 1 to 0, and the 0th bit, right, would be brought to the 7th position. Fine. So we get the result to be as 7, 8. Okay, so this is how the rotate right and rotate left instructions will work. The next, as we said, the remaining two instructions are with the carry. Now these two instructions, that is rotate right and rotate left, have not considered the carry into the rotate operations. But when we consider the carry as a part of the rotate instructions, so what happens? So the first one that we have is rotate right through carry the contents of the accumulator. Fine. So it means that when you are rotating right, the least significant bit would be copied into the carry. Rest all remains the same. So the least significant bit would be copied into the carry. So the next bit copies here 0, 1, 2, 3, then 4, 5, 6 and 7. So it keeps on moving. Then what will be available in the in the 7th bit? It would be the contents of the carry, which would go into the 7th bit. So let us understand through the example that we have written over there. It says move A9H, add A,14 and then rotate right through carry. Why this example is being taken? Only to say that how add instruction will reflect the carry and how the carry gets modified by using RR instruction. So when you perform the addition of A9 and 14, okay, both are hexadecimal. So after 9, it's A, B, C and D, and this is B. So what has happened over here? The carry flag is 0 on executing the first two instructions, move and add. Now when you use the instruction RRC, what it would be? So we have the contents of, before executing this instruction, the contents of accumulator is BB, right, and the contents of the carry is 0 as seen. So B is represented as 1, 1, 0, 0, which is equivalent to 2, sorry, this is C, B will be 1, 0, 1, 1. And B will be 1, 0, this is equivalent to D, 1, 1, 0, 1. And what is carry? Carry is 0. So executing this instruction, 1 gets into the carry, the first bit which is 0 into the 0th bit, 1 into the first bit, again 1 into the second bit, 1 into the third bit, 1 into the fourth bit, 0 into the 5th bit, again 1 into the 6th bit, carry which was here, right, would got into the 7th bit. So what we observe here is, the carry which was 0 previous to the execution of RRC, with RRC instruction, the carry is being modified to a value of 1 and the final result, that is 5E, is what gets loaded into the accumulator, right? Similarly, we have the instruction RLC, that is rotate left through carry. Same example is being put over here. If you pictorially, if you represent, what it would be is we have the carry flag, I'll show it on to the most significant side, because when you say rotate left, the seventh bit will go on to the carry. We have the remaining bits here, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 and 0. This is how it will move. So 0, the 7th bit would move into the carry, 6 into 7, 5 into 4 and so on. The carry bit would be moved into the 0th bit. Same thing can be observed in the example that we have put across. If the contents of A is 3C, that means 3 is 0, 0, 1, 1 and C is being represented as 1, 1, 0, 0 and we have used the next instruction as set BC, which means that the carry flag would be set with the value of 1. On you executing the instruction RLC accumulator, these are all the 7 bits that we have, 0 to 7, and this is the carry. So the 7th bit will move on to the carry, then this is 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0. So this carry, which is 1, will move on to the 0th bit. So what we observe, that the carry flag which was previously set, on using the instruction RLC for the contents of A to be as 3C, has changed to a value of 0. So this is how the carry flag can be used, right, to perform rotate right and as well as rotate left. So let us understand how rotate instruction can be used as multiplication as well as division. Let's take this example and then we will understand what the topic that I've put. So here we have written A to be as 003. So I'll just use the whiteboard. Yes. Okay, so this is what we have, that is move A comma 003. So what is that 003, which can be put written as 0000 and 3 is 0011. I'll just increase the font 2 minutes, hold on. Okay, so it is 0000 and 0011. Fine, so clear C when we say, then the carry would be equal to 0. Now it is rotate left C with A. Right, so rotate left when we say, it is what? The 7th bit. Let us do it here. Would be more. So it is 3 is represented as 0000 0011. This is the content of the accumulator. Clear C, C will be equal to 0. RLC, rotate left. So what is C? C is 0 initially. So when you rotate left, the 7th bit would move on to the carry. So carry will be 0. This moves 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1. And what is in C comes here? 0. So what is the value? It is 6H. Just make an observation. So RLC, when you do A, it is 6H. So what are the contents of accumulator? They are still with 6H. Again, we say it to be as RLC. So again 0 gets moved here, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1 shifts here, 1, 0, and this 0 becomes. What is this? 1, 1, 0, 0, it's a C in hexa and it is 12 in decimal. Okay, then next we perform rotate right through carry the contents of the accumulator. So when you say rotate right, the zeroth bit comes into the carry and carry goes over. I mean comes into, so it will be 0, 0, 0, 0, then next this 0 is getting shifted here, 1, 1, 0, and this 0 comes into the carry. So what do you get back? We get it as 6H. So what's the observation that we do from here? We see that when we say the first instruction RLC, the contents of A, it's being, you get the result to be as 6, which means it has doubled, or rather it has multiplied by 2. And again we say RLC A, so 6 gets multiplied by 2 and we get the result to be as 12. But the moment we say RRC, the value of 12 gets divided and we get 6, which means that back to the statement that we made, it's saying that the rotate instructions can be used for performing multiplication as well as division by 2. So RLC instruction along with the carry, when used, it is equivalent to multiplication by 2, and the RRC instruction, that is rotate right used with the carry, performs the operation of division by 2. So this is how you can use this instruction for as multiplier as well as the division. So let us take this example over here, which says example to convert 8-bit packed BCD number into 2 unpacked BCD numbers. So the logic goes, we'll read an 8-bit BCD number. Once we read that, then you need to AND it with 0F, get the lower nibble, store it, read the original number, get the higher one, and again store it. So how does it happen? If you say the number is 85, it's a BCD number, it's a packed BCD number. This number, after writing the program and executing, you should get the result as 05 and 0H. Okay, that is what the problem statement means, that you have to convert 8-bit packed BCD number into 2 unpacked BCD numbers. So we'll be basically using the logical operation instructions. That's why we have taken up this example, to understand where this logical instructions would be useful to us. So to get the lower nibble, we will AND it with 0F. So anything ANDed with 0 is 0, and we have seen that it masks off whenever it is ANDed with 0. So what we get? The result to be as 05. So we have got the lower nibble. Fine. So let us assume that this I will store it either in the memory or it could be in a resistor. Right? Then we need to take this original number again, 85. Now the lower nibble is already been obtained. You need the higher nibble. So we will AND it with F0. Okay. So when we AND it with F0, the lower nibble would be masked off, and you get the higher nibble as 8. But what is required? That you have to get it as 08, which means that I have to use the equivalent instruction of logical operations such that it becomes as what? 08. So what are the possibilities? Either you can go in for using rotate right 4 times so that you get, I mean, it's equivalent to the swap, or you can use swap instruction to do the job. Okay, so let's write the program for this. Okay. I'll just increase the font. Fine. So as we know, ORG 00H, then we'll say move R0 comma hash 20H. Fine. So this 20H is the one which I will be using it as the address of the internal RAM. Okay, wherein the 8-bit unpacked data would be available. Next, we need to read the data. So we'll say move A comma at the rate R0. So with this, what happens? The 8-bit unpacked data, BCD data, would be bought into the accumulator. Now, if you look at the example that we discussed over here, I need the origin number, because the moment you mask it, you are losing out on the original number. So we'll say move R2 comma A. So the original number is available into the register R2. So what's the next step, as discussed, is that we will say ANL A comma hash 0FH. So the first step, that is what we have done here. Okay, so what will be available now in the accumulator? The content of the lower nibble, as in the form of a byte, would be available in the accumulator. So what I'll do here is, instead of using a register to store the result, I will use the next consecutive memory location to store the unpacked BCD numbers. So now R0 is already pointing to the internal RAM of 20H, which has the original unpacked BCD number. I will increment R0 so that it points to 21 and store the lower nibble in the form of the byte. So I'll say increment R0. So R0, which was 20, now it has become 21. And then we'll say move. Where? What should I move? You should move the contents of accumulator into the memory location pointed by the resistor R0. So we'll say move at the rate R0 comma A. So you can execute this program and check out. So at the memory location 21, you'll be having the value that is 05 with respect to the example that we discussed. So now the original number is there in the resistor R2. So I get back into that accumulator as move A comma R2. So the original number is got. Now what we need to add? You need to add it with a value of F0 so that the higher nibble can be obtained. We'll say ANL A comma 0F0H. The first 0 is an indication for the controller that followed are the numbers, hexadecimal number F. It is not a variable, but we are actually masking it with a value of F0. So again, when we mask it, as per this example, it will be 80H. So I can use the instruction RRA 4 times. Which does the job of moving what? That 8, which is there as the higher nibble, into the lower nibble. Or all these 4 instructions together can be replaced with the swap instruction. Does the same job. So 80H, when you swap, it becomes 08H. Fine. So now this is the higher byte. Again, we say increment R0 and then move at the rate R0 comma A. Fine. So after executing this program, what you will observe in the memory location is, you'll observe that at the location 20H, you'll have the BCD number. Then at, if I put it in the horizontal itself, 20H, at location 21H will be 05, and 22H it will be 08. It's always good to go in for using a memory as the data storage so that during the runtime you can simply change the values and check for all the different possible test cases. Okay. So then another example to find the square of a number. So here when we say square of a number, it means a number is being read once and it is being multiplied twice and you get the result. So pretty simple example, read two 8-bit numbers. The same number has to be loaded into the accumulator as well as into the register B, because we'll be using here a MUL instruction to perform the square of a number, the multiplication, and then finally we can store the result into the register R3, R4, or you can also do in the similar way as we have done with respect to the memory. So how does it go ahead with? Let us write the program. We'll say move. R0, comma, hash 20H. Okay, maybe we can just modify the previous example only. Right. Move R0, get the first number. I'll just delete off these. Okay. So the number whose multiplication is to be performed, right, is bought into the accumulator. Now the same number has to be bought into register B. So when we have to get it into the register B, we have to use the address of B. To a larger extent, we will not be using the register name for B, but its address would be used. So we'll say move 0F0H. This is the address of register B, comma A, right? So A contains a number, B contains the same number, and then we'll say MUL AB. So the numbers are being multiplied and ultimately this comes as a square of a number. So put back into the register. As we know, the B contains the higher byte of the result and A contains the lower byte. So we can say INC increment R0 and then move at the rate R0 comma B, again increment R0 and move at the rate R0 comma A. Sorry, it's not R0 RO, it is R0 comma A. Okay. So after executing this instruction, what we will see, again the memory location 20H would contain the number whose square is to be found, fine, and then the 21st location will contain the higher byte of the result and the 22nd location will contain the lower byte of the result. So we have the another example. So these are small little examples which can be worked with all the instructions that we have discussed till date. Okay, that's why I thought we could work out on these examples, and these would also help you in your lab or even the theory exams. So example is again here to convert BCD number into ASCII number. So first we need to understand how a BCD number is converted into the ASCII equivalent. So what are ASCII numbers? If you take the numbers from 0 to 9, its ASCII equivalent is 30H to 39H. Fine? Which means that if the number is 0 BCD, I should get the equivalent as what? 30H. If the BCD number is 1, you should get it as 31, and so on. There is ASCII even for A, B, C, D and E, right, which is nothing but your 41H and so on, sorry, 47, 48, 4A and so on. But the problem statement says it is BCD into ASCII, and we know that the BCD numbers are only between 0 to 9. So if at all, and necessary not that this BCD number should be just a single digit, it can be of two digit also. So we'll consider the maximum possibility and write the program. So if I take the same example as I took previously, 85, part of the program is already covered in the previous example. Only small additions is what we need to do here. So if this is a number, right, 85, what we need to do first, you need to mask it with 0x. So you get the result to be as 0.5, and to this we are going to add 30h, and we get the result to be as 35h. So we have got the hex, the ASCII equivalent of that BCD number 5. So if it is a single digit, then you're done with the program. But I said when you talk about the BCD, since the controller supports byte data, I can have two digits. So that is what we have taken. So I have the again original number as 85. Now we will add it with 0f, and what we get the result as 80. Then we will swap or we will rotate. We get the result to be as 08. And to this we add the value 30h, and we get the result to be as 38. So in this example, we are able to get the ASCII equivalent of every BCD digit if it is a two digit. So similarly, if you have more number of digits, then you keep on adding 30 to it and you'll be able to get the ASCII equivalent. Now, since I said these are the examples that we are going to work with the logical operations, so instead of using add over here, I will use a logical OR operator. Okay, so the logical OR operator can be used to add 30H to the BCD number and get the result. So quickly let us see how it can be done. I again presume that the BCD number is available into the memory, that is 20H, can be taken as any address. We have got the first number into the accumulator, and then I store it. We'll say move R2 comma A, so the original number is not lost. Then we'll say ANL A comma hash 0FH. Hope previously also I've used hash. If not, please it should be hash, because you're ending with the constant or immediate value. So we have the result as example 05. Then we'll say ORL A comma the immediate value, that is hash 30H. So after executing this instruction, the equivalent value 35 would be available into the accumulator. We'll say increment R0 memory point, R0 point to the next memory location, and then we'll say move at the rate R0 comma A. So the first number ASCII equivalent of 5 in our example that we have taken, right, would be available on the hello. No video. Hello. Hello. Okay. So we have written a move at the rate R naught, comma A. So the first bit number is being copied into. Next we get back into the getting the data from R2 into accumulator. So we say move A comma R2. So the original number is brought back into the accumulator. Now we will AND it, ANL, with the value of hash 0F0H so that we get the higher nibble onto. Next we will swap the contents of accumulator so that the higher nibble would be bought into the lower, so we get that 0,8, and or ORL A comma hash 30H, right? So we have the higher ASCII equivalent available. We'll say increment R naught and then move at the rate R naught comma A. I'll just put it broad so that you are able to view it. Oh, I'm extremely sorry. Okay, so we have the program here. Fine. I hope the program is quite clear of converting BCD into the ASCII equivalent. Let us look into the next one. So the next example that we have is hex number to decimal. So the logic goes like this. You can read a hex number. So when you say hex number, it is between 00 to FF. And we have to do a consecutive division over here. We divide it by 10. Then we get the quotient in the resistor A. And that can be stored because that becomes your most significant number. The remainder which is there has to be bought into the accumulator. Okay, where it is available? It's available into the resistor B. Again, B has to be loaded with the number that is 10, 0AH, perform the division. And finally, the quotient and the remainder would be the next two digits of the decimal equivalent. Okay, so this program, I leave it to you to give a try. If not, you can just text me or anything, then maybe we can rewrite this program in the tomorrow's session. But a pretty simple program with the previous program's understanding, I think this program would be pretty simple. It's basically the number divided by 10. The quotient, first division quotient, becomes your first digit. If I take maximum as FF, which is nothing but 255. So FF divided by 10, ultimately the answer I should get it as 2, 5 and 5. Okay, so the second division, first division, I'll be able to get 2 as a quotient, store it. There is some remainder X. That remainder becomes your dividend and you divide it by 10. And further division, the quotient and remainder together would give you the result of the remaining two digits. I hope it's possible for you to write. Fine. So this is all just to conclude the today's session. Today's session, we began with understanding the bit addressable memory, which we had already seen into our module 1, because that helped us to understand the further instructions associated with bit addressable. And then we discussed in detail the rotate instructions, rotate right, rotate left, rotate right and rotate left with the carry. And we saw how this rotate right and rotate left with carry can help us in performing multiplication by 2 and division by 2. And in the today's session, more than the instructions that are being covered, we have taken more of examples which could be written based on the instructions that we have studied. So we have taken up the example of the code conversions from BCD to packed BCD to unpacked BCD, BCD to your ASCII equivalent. Then we have also seen how we can perform square of a number. The square of a number can also be extended to find the cube of a number. The result stored, then you have written, but there only the constraint comes as your cube of a number again is restricted to a 16-bit data. Fine. So if the data, I mean, the result goes beyond 16-bit, then the program becomes a bit complex, wherein you have to temporarily store it in the memory, get it back, and do some additional instructions to take care of. But if you are looking at the maximum result to be just 16-bit, then I think the same example, I mean, the same program with further the result, whatever AB we have obtained, you further multiply it with B again, then you should be able to get the result. So with this, we wind up with the today's session, and in the tomorrow session, or that is the next week sessions, we'll start with the last category of the instructions, that is the control instructions. So after studying these control instructions, we could do lot number of examples where you have got some iterative, programs containing iterative operations and all to be done, which we will take up in the next class.